through it, but we'll start it at verse number 4 give us an opportunity to take a look at this scripture, and particularly the way in which I think it can help us be more faithful to this call. Many of you have seen these candles that are in your seats and your chairs. I'm not going to ask you to light the candles while you're here, but I would like for you to keep this as a mental image and hopefully a concrete object that you can take with you as you leave that will remind you and I of one commitment we can make to shine our light. And I want to challenge you as you go throughout the week to take this, and wherever you feel like you need to shine your light, I want you to place this in that environment, all right? As a reminder, it may be on your job, it may be in your home, it may be while you drive into work so you don't, you know, get the road rage spirit. I don't know, it may be with your children. It may be in the neighborhood, maybe just put it outside your door, whatever it is. But I believe that sometimes taking some concrete things with us, so when we see it, we can be reminded of a commitment we need to make. Because the Bible says that what good is it to hear the word but not do anything? It's important for us to be doers of the word as well, all right? So you can just kind of put this down or hold on to it, clutch it, whatever you need to do. But we'll hopefully use this as an object of our referral for the rest of our time together. John chapter number 1, verse 4. The scripture starts in verse number 4. In him was life, and the life was the light of all people. The light shines in darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. Talking about John the Baptist, all right? John the Baptist was the cousin of Jesus, so he was someone that was fully aware of who Jesus was. He was sent as a messenger, as a witness, to testify to the light so that all might believe through him. He, talking about John himself, was not the light, but he came to testify to the light. The true light, which enlightens everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world came into being through him. Yet the world did not know him. He came to what was his own, and his own did not accept him. But to all who received him, who believed in his name, he gave power to become children of God, who were born not of blood, or of the will of the flesh, or of the will of man, but of God. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Let us say thanks be to God. We're going to spend a few moments in here talking a little bit about this idea, continuously light it up, light it up, light it up. Bow your heads with me as we pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, bless the word of God that has been read for us, the people of God. We ask you to hide this word in our heart so we will not sin against you. And please send your anointing that makes preaching and teaching easy. This is our prayer. In Jesus' name we pray. Let the people of God say amen. 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 Somebody say it again. Light it up. Light it up. Light it up. Now, one of the great amazing things about the gospel of Jesus is that too often the tendency of humanity is to make that which is beyond our grasp domesticated and accommodated to what keeps us comfortable. So when you understand that Jesus came not to keep you and I in the place of comfort where we are, but Jesus came to really turn your life and the world upside right. Hello, somebody. Amen. I know some of you folk, some of us that, you know, got a little education and a little money, come from good stock. Amen. We don't think there's nothing wrong with our lives. But for the rest of us up in here, amen, how many of you know you could use a little bit of upside rightness going on in your life, your family, your life, your community? Yeah, and what's so fascinating again about the way in which Jesus is often domesticated kind of reduced into the boxes of human ideas and expressions is that rather than worshiping Jesus, we often start to worship an image of ourselves that we just put Jesus' name on. And part of what I believe you and I must fully appreciate is that the moment you think you figured out what Jesus is going to do is the moment you've probably stopped worshiping the true Jesus. Hello, somebody. Amen. Just think about all the different folk in Scripture that were always deeply surprised, troubled, and made uncomfortable by Jesus. His family, his disciples, the people, the crowds, the political structures, the religious structures. Amen. Jesus was not somebody that fit into anybody's camp perfectly. Jesus was always somebody who, whenever he showed up, folk would be like, oh. Jesus. So I thought I had a day without no conviction. Here comes Jesus. Amen. We sanitized Jesus. We made Jesus, in many respects, more like us than we have become like him. And I love how often this is also done with these great giants of moral integrity, heroes in our societies. We reduce them. Dr. Martin Luther King is one of these such individuals. His legacy is often sanitized. He is often thought of as this dreamer, this person that just had this magnanimous dream, and he did have that. Amen. But how many of you know that Dr. King was not a popular person when he was alive? Man, Dr. King was not somebody where everybody saw him coming, they'd be like, yay, Dr. King! Come on up here, Martin King, and just come on, just tear up, take our city and just put it on, shut it down mode. Amen. It wasn't that kind of thing going on. When Dr. King showed up, folk did the same thing. Oh. Some folk even disinvited him from coming to their city. Some folk kicked him out of their city. And we all know, at least we should know, that, you know, the King family did a civil trial against the U.S. government to prove that they were complicit in his assassination, and they won a civil trial. But I think all they asked for was a dollar or something like that. I told them, I said, man, if something happened to me and y'all think the government did it, you better get more than a dollar. Get a billion or two or something. End all this poverty around here, praise God. But isn't it fascinating that we love dead revolutionaries but hate living prophets? Right? We'll just celebrate folk. Jesus, when he was here, boy, you know, he was somebody that they didn't like to see coming. But after he went off the scene, there were a whole lot of folk who was like, surely this was the Son of God. Yeah, it took you to hang him on a cross and break his body and do all this kind of stuff. Part of what I want to submit to you, my brothers and sisters, today is that Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. was more than a civil rights leader. If you listen to his own story and his own self-description, he would say that I am the son of a Baptist preacher, the grandson of a Baptist preacher, the great grandson of a Baptist preacher. My whole life has been in the service of God and his church. That he was a follower of Jesus, whose ministry and reach spilled out into the world. And if there is an assignment for all of us who are contemplating what does it mean for the light of this gospel of Jesus to shine in our lives. Dr. King is one great example because most people are deeply inspired by Dr. King, whether they find themselves as a follower of Jesus or not. That his ministry and his actions in the church and in the world has left such an imprint that people draw strength and wisdom and direction and inspiration and truth and light because, as we said a couple of weeks ago, the light of the gospel shined in his life so brightly that it was then reflected to the world. And could it be that what the church needs to be in the 21st century, more than a place where we come and just sing praise and worship songs, although we must do that, more than a place where we come and say prayers, although we must do that, more than a place where we come on Sundays and hear good teaching and preaching, although we must do that, that the church must be a place where the light of the gospel can shine on us in a way that it lights up the world all around us. Now, it's clear that the church historically has not lived up to this charge, that we are often known for everything except light up some places. Amen. Some of us have been so formed and shaped in this kind of church that when we show up, we are not like the light of the gospel, we're more like the black hole. You know, the place where light goes to die. Hello, somebody. And part of what I love about this scripture that we've read this morning is that it is a description of Jesus, the incarnate one, his whole existence as we understand it from below. It describes Jesus as being there at the beginning, meaning that Jesus is, was, and always will be the uncreated one. He lives in fellowship with God the Father, the Son, Holy Spirit, the Trinity, the Godhead, one God living eternally. But through the grace and the love that was shown by our God, Jesus broke into our reality and said, I will not leave the world to your own devices, but I will make a way to shine light in the darkness so people can find a way to the way of living that I intended when I created you back in the day before any of y'all was around. Let me just say this to you, that there is no greater love that we can see than the love that God has shown to us by putting God's own self in our situations, our material world, to give us salvation that is full and complete and a pathway into life in this time and the next that is fully reflective of who God is and what God intends for us to be. And yet we know and see that when Jesus showed up, the people did not receive him. His light seemed to be too bright for folks to be able to accept or understand. And when we reflect on Jesus and one of his great followers, disciples today, Dr. Martin Luther King, I think it's the same thing. I think too often we are so unaware of the magnanimity of the vision that Dr. King was bringing to the world. Of course he had a dream, but how many of you know his dream was undergirded by some particular understandings of how we should interact with one another? It was a love revolutionary and radical that he talked about, a love that required a certain kind of interaction with one another that always reminded us that we are all created in the image of God. That even if I don't like you per se, I have to still show you basic dignity and respect. Even if I disagree wholeheartedly with what you choose to do, with how you choose to do it, with who you do it with when you do it, that I still through it. I mean, now, when Dr. King was talking about accessing, you know, the right to vote, that made some folk a little upset, but you know, that didn't cost too much money. When Dr. King was talking about, you know, having folk ride on the bus or eat at a Woolworths counter or drink out of a water fountain, that was, you know, a little upsetting to the social status quo, but you know, that didn't really cost too much money. As a matter of fact, it actually increased the economy. Because how many know that dollar that we were spending is still the same dollar that, you know, the white folk is spending, praise God. So it wasn't like we had a special dollar. That dollar had George Washington on it just like everybody else. Amen. So it's like, this may be a good economic decision to keep the money from only staying within the black communities, the segregated communities. Amen. I can eat from that. Amen. I can benefit from some of that. But when Dr. King started talking about, all right, now we need to end all these wars.
Why?
Because every time you fire a missile, you are actually taking money out of the pockets of poor folk, food off the table of the hungry. You're making sure that we can't build a school. They said, wait a minute now, Martin King. When he started talking about every single person should have a, listen to this, guaranteed income. Meaning that nobody should not have any money anytime. Wait a minute, Martin King. When he starts talking about nobody should be living homeless. All right, you dipping into art, billions of dollars of, you know, money here, and you got the gold. And they did. They killed and assassinated Dr. King because his social vision was too much for a country committed to greed, power, and domination. This is the light that I believe reflected from the light of the gospel of Jesus. Dr. King, from his own admission, didn't just think this stuff up while he was laying on a bed at night. But he said that if I follow the ways of Jesus, then I must be concerned about the least of these. It is a legacy that is our legacy because we are the church, the body of Christ. And we cannot be a church that reflects capitalistic, consumeristic, materialistic ways when Jesus' life and the lives of those who exemplify his life are totally antithetical to that. You and I would be a powerful light shining in the darkness of exploitation and exclusion, prejudice and racism, if we ourselves could live a life that reflects this light. People say, oh, what must I do to be saved? Some of us gotta do more than what we're doing right now. Hello, somebody. Amen. I want you to confess with your mouth and believe in your heart that God raised Jesus from the dead and you shall be saved. Absolutely. And you must also understand that this salvation should change you and I. Not just to have individual piety. Things I used to do, I don't do them anymore. I don't smoke, I don't drink, I don't steal, I don't gamble, I don't kill, I don't lie, I don't cheat, except on my taxes when I need a few extra dollars to go buy that purse, but that's beyond the point. I don't gossip except when it's that person I really don't like that much. You know, I'm not talking about personal piety. Although we should have a different kind of behavior. Hello, somebody. But there are a few things that I think you and I must also imagine if we're going to take seriously, and I'm going to lift up some of these ideas on these last few moments we have remaining. The first thing that you and I must appreciate, if we're going to bear or shine this light of the gospel through the world, the first thing you and I have to appreciate is that we must be and bear witness to the light. Everybody say, be a witness, be a witness. Now, understand, my brothers, that there is a prerequisite for you being a witness. get just for Mike Brown and the lying, evil, duplicitous, on his way to hell, district attorney McCullough, putting folk on the witness stand that hadn't seen a thing. So how many of you know when you claim to be a witness of something you have not seen, you become a liar. You make up stuff. You take what you hear other people say and you put your nice little old spin on it. But that's not the kind of witness that we find here in Scripture. The Bible says that John the Baptist came as a messenger to bear witness of the light. In order for you to be a witness, you have to have seen something that you are convinced about. It can't be what you heard. My mama and them told me that, Lord, you are good in your mercy and hope. Oh, thank you, Jesus, forever. It can't be what you read in a book. I'm talking about an experience that is undeniable. I love this quote that Dr. King, in one of his speeches, he said it like this: by opening our lives to God in Christ, we become new creatures. This experience which Jesus spoke of as the new birth is essential if we are to be transformed nonconformists. Only through an inner spiritual transformation do we gain the strength to fight vigorously the evils of the world in a humble and loving spirit. Listen, my brothers and sisters, you have to become a witness to the experience of Jesus coming in your life. Why? Because it starts to equip you to do this fight against evil and oppression in a way where you do not become that which you hate. Now, we talk about just, let's come on down into our everyday lives. Because for many of us, the enemy is not in our minds concretely systems and powers. Most of us struggle with just enemies in our families. These nagging folk and situations that seem to bring the worst out in us, not the best. Do I have an honest person here today? I mean, you know the people that you just, you know, you like, you know, this is where I think, you know, we heard that song, Lord, I want to be a Christian in my heart. Amen. Because, you know, there's some folk that make my body not Christian-like. Amen. Hello, somebody. Right? That there's often this idea that unless you have an experience with God, you're able to bear witness to a different kind of story. Now, I like this idea of witness too because it keeps you and I real clear about our role in this process. John the Baptist was not the light. Martin Luther King is not the light. We are not the light. We are here to bear witness to the light. You just have to wait. You got to trust him and give him more time. No matter how long it takes. He's a God that you can't hurry. He'll be there. So don't you worry. He may not come and you won't worry. He's right on time. This isn't important. particularly for us personally, because many of us forget that bearing witness is different from being the Messiah. And how many of you know in some of our lives we can fall into the wrong role? We think that we're actually here to save and to fix everything and to make everything better and turn out a certain kind of way. But in actuality, all you're there is to bear witness. You are there to reflect that which has shined on you. And as you and I move throughout our week, think about this. How are you then called to bear witness? Clinically, some of that's called codependency. You know, sometimes in our relationships where we have all these overlapping, addictive, dysfunctional things happening, we forget that I am just here to bear witness of what healthy living looks like. I cannot control what you're going to do. I barely can't control what I can do. So I'm not here to fix you. I'm just here to bear witness. And I was, me and Dr. Cornell West were in jail together. You know, he was in there. Oh, God, there's a good brother, good brother, good brother, good brother. I mean, you taking our mugshot. Oh, good brother, where do you want me to stand? He just smiling and waiting. I'm looking at him. I have my little Hunter's Point mug on my shirt.
To speak, to act, to carry ourselves.
where everyone could be and flourish. Think about that kind of vision. Think about the vision that you testify about. When your imagination is small, you will have a small testimony. If all you love is black folk, then your whole story will be about black folk. If all you love is white folk, your whole story will be white. If all you love is money, if all you love is your culture, Latino, Asian, gay, straight, rich, poor, Christian, Buddhist, Muslim, go down every single identity category you can think of. If you are so consumed with that, then you have a small imagination. Because Dr. King, when you read about Dr. King, he always talks about the brotherhood of men. Today, you know, because of our gender inclusive language, I would just change that to our shared humanity. Yeah. All of us fit in the vision of God in the world. All of us. Even though people you don't like or agree with, they fit in God's vision for the world. You better leave that up to God. Because it ain't nothing worse than you thinking you are on the inside. And you actually on the outside. Jesus said like this to the folk. Some folk will come to heaven saying, Lord, Lord, Jesus is going to say, I didn't know who you are. What? Wait, what? What? Wait. I went to church. I wasn't at your church. I read the Bible. I wasn't in that Bible though. Well, where were you? I was with the prisoners. So if you are so uncomfortable, you can't hang around people who made mistakes in their life. You ain't testifying. You testifying. If you are so uncomfortable hanging around folk who got all kind of, you know, idiosyncrasies, you know, you, my brothers and sisters, your testimony has to be broad enough. If it's coming from God. If it is the light of God, remember, this light that's shining on me and making me sweat like I'm running a marathon, I can't control where that light goes. I can't. I can put my hand up, and I can block the light, but y'all still being lit up by the light. Light is not in the control of the receiver of the light. Light is the source of the light controls the light. Only way for me to control that light is to unplug it. And how many know you ain't unplugging God? I know you got a little bit of power and education right now. So what are you willing to testify about? Dr. King, I love this quote here. He says that, listen, when I testify, when I talk about this beloved community, the end is reconciliation. The end is redemption. The end is the creation of the beloved community. It is this type of spirit, this type of love that can transform opposers into friends. It is an overflowing love which seeks nothing in return. It is the love of God working in the lives of people. This is the love that may well be the salvation of our civilization. This love. This love is what we must testify. And listen, when you testify, let me just say this to you. You must tell the truth in your testifying. You must name some demons. And you have to proclaim a future. You got to tell the truth. Don't be standing up making up stuff. Tell the truth. What's your story? What did God do? Where did God bring you from? Let that light shine. But you also got to name some demons. Name some evils. Dr. King, in his stories of testimony, he always named the three evils that we must fight against. Racism. Materialism. Militarism. Racism. White supremacy. Bias. Prejudice. Privilege. These forces and systems that devalue certain people's lives that don't reach the ideal, the unrealistic and idolatrous ideal of whiteness. That if you don't match up to this ideal of whiteness, that your life is not valuable. Dr. King said that's like the elite male who's white, then you are on the lower totem pole. I don't know how many uber wealthy elite white males we have running around. Usually they in the 1%, and I hope I got a few of you 1%ers in here. Praise God. We got some stuff we got to fix. Help somebody. Don't be hiding. Amen. Don't be hiding. But if that's not true, then the world has not been shaped around whatever your deficit according to that standard is. Dr. King said, we gotta fight against that. Militarism. It ain't just the military over there either. Our police forces have become so militarized. They spend, in the city of Oakland, $200 million on the police department. $200 million, can you believe that? $200 million. And they can't even stop no crime. What kind of investment is that? Hello, somebody. I'm about to get on the tangent. Remember, I'm not in that meeting. I'm preaching. But I tell you what, I bet you if we reduce the amount of money we spend on police and prisons, and we put it into education and schools, we make sure that every single person had a hot meal in the morning, in the afternoon, and the evening. Everybody had some heat in their house. I bet you folks don't be out here trying to rob nobody. What would you rob somebody for? I got food. I'm not cold. Hello, somebody. I'm going to mess with y'all. But you know how you become since you started fasting. You that fasting. And I'm not even talking about a cold turkey fast. I'm talking about I dare you, listen to me, to just cut sugar out of your diet and watch how grouchy you become. Watch how incorrigible, watch how restless, watch how mean. When you stop eating sugar, you can eat whatever else you want, but just don't eat no sugar. I'm telling you now, because I did it. And I realized I was possessed with a demon. So can you imagine how people are feeling when they literally don't have no food? How irrational they are when they don't have no food? When they look Latino and Asian, we human beings, when you hungry, you gonna do whatever you can to get some food. But we don't believe that about each other. We believe that we're just inherently criminal. So because of that, I'm gonna spend $200 million on a police officer to drive around and make sure that I can stop you from doing something that don't got nothing to do with your behavior, more to do with your needs. Couldn't the church carry that vision into the world? What if we just walked around, everybody deserves to eat food. Food! Not talking about you deserve to live in a mansion. Every child, before they go to school, deserves to eat food. That's why they killed Dr. King, y'all. Because he was starting to mess with the formula of the elite. That's why they killed Jesus, y'all. He was messing with the formula of the elite. And we in the church, we better understand that when you start messing with the systems and the powers of this age, you're gonna welcome a little bit of extra attention. But then this is where I love this last part. It says that to they who receive Jesus, this light, they have the power. Amen.
You can withstand all of the onslaught of the enemies. The enemies within you and the enemies outside of you. Because the power of God cannot be defeated by any other power. And for many of us, we think that we can do this work of bearing witness, this work of testifying, without receiving the power of God. But the power of God is an important catalyst. It's an important sustainer for you and I to keep bearing the light, shining the light of God's glory into the world. You and I must have God's power. I don't know about you, but I always could use a little more power from God. Maybe if you spend some time actually reordering the practices in your life so you can tap into this power that is readily available to whoever would want it. God is not rationing God's power. God is not like PG&E that will only give you a certain amount. Then you gotta pay a penalty. God gives liberally, generously to all who ask. The problem with many of us is we don't ask for the power of God. When we ask for the power of the state, of our company, of our education, of our money. When was the last time someone said, if you can have one thing, what would it be? I want the winning ticket from Powerball. I understand. That's a lot of money now. But what if you really believe that all you needed was the power of God to become? That just seems so just esoteric and otherworldly, and it is supernatural. Well, that ain't gonna really help too much. Well, I was talking with one of my mentors the other day, and I was talking about we both were licking our wounds because we're both pretty, you know, in the framework of what success and power looks like in our fields, we are pretty well positioned. And we were both bemoaning how what we thought we would be able to accomplish if we just got access. Right? Like, we can just, I know I'm talking to this person, but if I can just talk to that person, surely. And it's so fascinating, the elusiveness of how power works. I would bring Tiffany and some of these other scholars up here to talk about Foucault and Derrida and their notions of power, and just tickle your intellect for a few moments. But we don't have time for that. I'll just say this, that power is not found in one place in the systems of our world. Power is moving, it's like whack-a-mole. But the power of God is something that if you and I can grab a hold to it, it will not leave you powerless. Now, you may not always have the things that this world defines as power. But when you have the power of God, I have found, and many of our ancestors have found, that that can sustain you in those moments in your life when you don't have the world's power.
turned 40, so you know, I'm getting a little bit older. So for a lot of us who may be a little younger, some of this just is so antithetical to how we've been shaped. Because we've been shaped to chase after the power of this world. Chase after the degrees, chase after the money, chase after the positions so you can have self-determination. And I'm not telling you not to do that, because even in the ministry that I believe we're called to do, we should be pushing forward to put these powers in the service of God and God's justice and vision for the world. What I am telling you is, don't do it without the light.